Homesteads and Homeschools as part of the Liberty Hippie Podcast Network. If you like what we do, be sure to check out This Week in Liberpods, Peace Freaks, Cannabis Heals Me, and Free Markets Green Earth. We're living proof that libertarian doesn't mean washed up Republican.
Whoa there. Slow down. You went too fast. Welcome back to another episode of Homesteads and Homeschools, the podcast. Today's episode number 71, which means you can find the show notes at homesteadsandhomeschools.com/071. I am your host, the Liberty Hippie, here with you today, bringing you this delightful little ear candy for you to suck on and savor and get something from, I guess, right? Little sugar high, little something, little rush. Anyway, folks, my guest today, a little different. Usually I have homesteaders on, I have homeschoolers on, something like that. Not so much today. So her name is Miss Allie J. Allie Jill, I believe. You can find her on Twitter, and that is in the show notes. And we'll get into it, and you can hear all about her and all about why I had her on today to talk about school and all that good stuff. So let's go plant those liberty seeds with my guest, Miss Allie J. Guest today is Miss Allie. I found her sort of on Twitter and Discord and seeing her around, and thought I'd have her on the show. Kind of an interesting perspective after a little while, but we'll get into it. So, yeah, short introduction today. I'm frazzled. So, Allie, welcome to the show. Thank you for coming on. Appreciate it.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's been
always fun.
Yeah, you know, it's those technology things always frazzle me no matter what happens. I'm a boomer at heart, I guess. I don't know. But so usually, you know, I talk to homeschool people, right? People that have been homeschooled, people that are homeschooling. And you don't fall into that category, right?
No, I don't. I used to be a public school teacher. So that's...
So what was your school like growing up then? Did you enjoy your elementary, secondary education that happened there? Or?
Not really. I mean, I did K through 12. I did K through 12 in public school, and it just kind of seemed like that's what everybody did because that's what was like socially accepted or whatever. I also grew up in a big family, one of six kids. So there were a lot of us. But most of my school, I had maybe like one or two teachers throughout the entire time that I could say I actually liked. I had mostly a negative experience, either with, you know, things like bullying or just teachers who weren't nice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's curious. You know, everybody you think about teachers and they're supposed to be these kind, loving, warm individuals, and they're not to slag teachers off, but, I mean, we all have our days, you know, and when you're around kids like that, it's going to happen. And sometimes it falls out on the students, and it's not a pleasant experience. So some folks are better at containing it, I guess, than others. So you I don't know, why did you decide to be a teacher, I guess?
Well, I mean, I actually wanted to be an interior designer when I was a junior in high school, but I was kind of pushed away from that because, you know, there's no money in that. you know, and a lot of my generation, I'm a millennial, so they kind of pushed because the generation before us, or my parents, would have been, you know, people who weren't necessarily college educated. So you have a lot of that, especially in high schools too, pushing people to go to college and not necessarily seeking alternate paths. And so I, you know, I didn't know what I wanted to do, and people, because I babysat a lot, because I tutored a lot in high school, everyone was like, you'd be a great teacher. So I'm like, I guess I'll do that. So
yeah,
it's like a little different.
Yeah, it is. But, you know, I think it
kind of works that way sometimes, right? Like some people really want to teach, some people, it kind of fits. You look at like the things that you have done growing up and what you're comfortable doing or where you kind of excel at, or, you know, and you just kind of fall into it, I guess. Did you, when you got into college, is that what you started out doing, education, or did you kind of get into that midway through, or how'd that go?
Yeah, so I started out in education, and I was a double major with history as well, because if you know anything about the No Child Left Behind Act, which was a big thing at the time, that was came out, I think, in 2001, and I graduated high school like 2003, so it was relatively new when I was going into college. And it said you had to be like highly qualified, so I also picked up a history major as well, because you had to have something else other than just education. And then as I did more with my education degree, did more practicums, I realized that the kids I was drawn to help more were like the special education kids, because they were more of a challenge for me, and I was kind of bored with like the general education classroom. So then I eventually, I think like 2 years into my schooling, I picked up an endorsement in special education. So I always thought they were the fun kids too, because, you know, they don't necessarily listen according to what public schools would want you to.
yeah. It can be an interesting classroom. I spent a little time doing that. It was a very curious experience, to say the least. But did you just do 4 years, or did you get your master's?
No, I just did 4 years. I did just my bachelor's degree, because I didn't stick around long enough for it to be worth it. Because most of the time, there were some programs where you could just do it 5 years straight through, but a lot of people I knew did their bachelor's, and if they were hanging around, they'd get the school district to try and pay for their master's degree, which I didn't stay in teaching for that long.
Yeah. So, okay. Cause I know I was in New York, and I forget how exactly it went. I think you could do your bachelor's, and then you had to get your master's. And then, you know, once you had your master's, then you had to teach like 5 years to get like permanent certification or something, you know, all these certificates, all these pieces of paper that said you were highly qualified, you know, or whatever their ridiculous terminology was. How long did you end up teaching for?
Pretty much I was out after the first year. Most people leave, I think, within like the first 5 years or whatever, but I just found it really frustrating once I got into like the actual school system.
Did you see any of that sort of frustration when you were doing your practicums and stuff, your student teaching and whatnot?
Yes, I did. That was actually where I found out, I think I told you this on Discord, that if you are in New Jersey, when you're taking standardized tests, this is the first time I'd heard this, that if you have a script, and if you go off of that script, then if somebody from the state hears that you go off that script to kind of like help a kid or say it differently, that you could potentially lose your license. And like, that's kind of insane. So, because I had a teacher who was like, I think she was like fourth grade or something, and we were there just around the time where they were doing standardized testing. And you know, you could just hear it in her voice. Like, it's so annoying. Because, and it's hard too, because like, if you have to watch a kid struggle with something that's like, I could help them a little bit, but you're not allowed to.
Yeah. And it's just absurd, right? I mean, like in regular day, quote, real life, if you don't understand something, you know, the first time somebody says something, they'll repeat it for you in a different way. And that's okay. That's how people operate. You know, it's absurd. I remember some of that, when I was, you know, teaching, and I subbed for a long-term sub in kindergarten. It was like a one-on-one for a little guy who's a runner. But, you know, there was a time, I think it was probably about a week and a half, where the actual teacher was out in the hallway doing one-on-one testing, like with these little kids. And I was in the classroom, and the school district had to hire a sub. And it's like, what do teachers go to school for? You know, when they spend, you know, a quarter of the year preparing for these tests, sitting one-on-one with kids doing just tests, right? You're not even helping them. It's wild.
Yeah, it's more like you end up teaching to the tests as opposed to actually teaching information that could be useful for them.
Yeah, for sure. And that's, you know, I think all these standards that are, you know, supposed to help and just mandated down, it's, you know, you get stuck, and it's tough because, you know, teachers can go either way. You know, you have your lazy teachers that are tenured, and, you know, the union won't let you get rid of them. And then you have your teachers that actually care. And it's a mixed bag, you know. It is. The teachers that care are going to feel really hard done by that. You know, they don't want to. That's not why people go into teaching, right? To just give out tests and do all that. But what did you, what grade levels did you teach, or where was your certification or whatever?
So my certification would have been elementary school, and I was with third and fourth grade.
Gotcha. So were you in like a kind of a contained classroom, or was it like resource room type stuff, or one-on-one, or what were you doing?
Yeah, it was like a small group, because I had the special education part of it. So it was like combined. And then we would go into the classroom, or like I would go into the classroom for different grade levels for different subjects. So like we would pull them for English, English or like language or whatever you want to call it, and reading and that type of thing. They would get pulled and come and hang out in one classroom. But then for math, I would go to like a fourth grade classroom. And I would be with that teacher just as support kind of thing. So,
yeah, that works. That's you know, I think they're kind of doing away with like the really self-contained classrooms, aren't they? To some degree, like I
think so. Yeah. Cause the big thing when I was going to school was like inclusion and trying to, you know, include children with special needs as much as they could in the general education classroom, as opposed to just constantly having them pulled to the side.
I guess you didn't enjoy it at all. What was it that really kind of frustrated you or set you off?
Yeah. Well, I mean, this is the thing. I think a lot of people just assume like, oh, could you not deal with the kids or whatever? And it's like, no, I love dealing with them. Like, I thought they were great and really cool and interesting. And it was always fun to see them like pick up something and, you know, that light in their eyes when they're like, oh, I get it now. but it was a lot of like the political background, the administration type thing that they weren't necessarily super supportive. So when I went to college, a lot of them would say like, oh, you have some autonomy or whatever. And you kind of do, but not really, because the state pretty much just mandates like, here's what you actually have to teach. So, you know, it's all that type of stuff. Just like the background things just were very frustrating and annoying.
I remember some of that, right? Like you... And I guess maybe like if you're there long enough, you can get some sort of autonomy, but between having to turn in, you know, lesson plans, like daily lesson plans broken down into like 10-minute segments, like every day for like the first, you know, however many years it takes to get that certificate, that then you have to get updated every, you know, 5 years and all that stuff. But it sucks so much out of teaching and so much that you could actually give to the kids, you can't.
Yeah, because you kind of end up like doing like more paperwork and that type of thing, and then you know, and you always take your work home with you anyway, because like you're spending so much time doing all the other stuff, and you know.
yeah, I hear you. So getting out of it, did you just kind of not go back for a second year, or was it something you kind of quit midway, or how did that go?
It was just not coming back for the next year. And I had kind of decided maybe I wanted to try something else, a different career.
Yeah.
So.
Fair enough. Did you get any pushback from administration or anything? Or how are they about checking out?
Not really. And a lot of it, so just to kind of talk about New Jersey a little bit at the time, was there were a lot of teachers who were in the state of New Jersey. So it's very competitive. But whenever they ran out of funding, which sometimes they would do, first year teachers were the first ones to go. So, cause they don't have that tenure. So, yeah.
Yeah. It's a doozy. You gotta get a stronger union in there, right? Keep everybody on.
Yeah.
that's always, I just had a long talk with my kids today about like unions and, you know, all that they do and all that they encompass. It's a curious thing, but I don't know. Do you miss it at all? Any aspects of it that you wish you could have back or check into again?
I mean, I guess I do like miss working with the kids, because they're, I think it's an interesting position, but I just don't, I mean, the structure of public schools, I don't miss that at all. I don't miss the lesson plans. I don't miss having to go through a bunch of standards and figure out which one applies to your lesson plan and what, you know, all of that stuff, and having to figure out the books that they use, because they all, each district uses, you know, their own ones that they pick and buy and purchase, and here's what you're going to do. Yeah, so I don't miss any of that stuff, but I thought, you know, working with the kids was, you know, fun, because it's kind of exciting, because you can get up, you can walk around and move around, because now I work in research and it's a lot of data, so it's like a little bit more on the boring side because you sit around all day, so, you know,
yeah,
you're not up and talking and that type of thing much, so.
Good deal. So, okay, so I guess kind of give people an idea. I think, you know, sometimes, unless you're a teacher, I think you don't recognize some of the rigmarole, some of the actual structure that's involved in like teaching or involved in what you have to do or turn in or adhere to. So you'd write lesson plans. When you talk about the standards, what were you doing with that? What would you have to do with all that? Or when you say standards, what do you mean?
Yeah. So there are standards for, like what you actually have to teach, for the curriculum, and they're numbered. So you have to go by like your state standards, and you'd have to go through and you have to prove why you're teaching that lesson, basically, by saying, here, I'm addressing this state standard. And you put the number down so you can say like, here's what I'm addressing. And then here's the lesson plan. You break it down into different, like you do like an overview and different, there are different aspects to it too. And you have to time it and say like, here's, we're doing this from this to this time, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. But you had to use the state standards that were already developed in order to prove that like, okay, this is why I'm teaching this lesson, because you shouldn't have been teaching something if it didn't have one that applied to it, if that makes sense. Right.
Yep. Yeah. How many, do you know how many standards there were for like, I don't know, ELA or any kind of given subject?
I don't even remember. It was so long ago. So okay. To be fair, it was like 10 years ago. So that I was teaching. So I don't remember off the top of my head.
Yeah. No, I know we're down here in Georgia, and we did the homeschooling, you know, certificate or whatever, you sign a document online and say, I'm going to homeschool my kids. And like, okay, sure. Great. But, we looked at a moment, at the Georgia state standards, and it's amazing how many they can fit in. Right. And mm-hmm. it's all not quite legalese, but it is, it's all just like these really complex ideas and complex sentences that like when you sit and you actually like break it down, you could summarize it in one very concise, easy to read sentence. But it's not. And it really kind of.
Well, and they each have like subsections too. I do remember that. Like it'd be okay, here's like standard 3.2.12, you know, and it was just like this long line of like numbers because they were different portions to it.
Yeah. And when you talk about, you know, not having autonomy to do that, like there it is, right? It you have just every minute thing that you have to do, you have to say, and it's all wrapped in. And when you're trying to teach to some of those things, when you're trying to, you know, make sure, oh, I encompass this or I get that guy or whatever, it can almost take away from what you're actually trying to convey, the message you're trying to get across to kids. It's wild. And I just, it's one of those things that I think when people kind of realize a little bit more how structured or how just rigid it is, what teachers can teach, it makes the homeschooling look a little bit better. But do you know if private schools have to adhere to the same sort of standards and stuff?
I don't think that they did at the time in New Jersey. I mean, they do have a state component to it, but I don't think they're as specific as with the public schools. Because I know that they don't necessarily have to take the same standardized testing and that type of thing either. I mean, I think they can opt to do it, but they don't have to. It may have changed since then, but that was what it was at the time.
So. Yeah, I know. So what are you doing now?
So I work in cancer research.
Okay.
I've worked in research for, you know, the last 10 years. I worked in oncofertility for a bit. And then before that, I worked in cardiology. And then now I'm just in oncology research and the data side of trials, clinical research trials.
How did you pick that? How did you make that transition?
Well, I thought for a minute I might want to go to medical school. So I went back to take my prereqs to do a post-bac program, where it's basically like a night school for people who want to work during the day, already have a college degree, but just need to take those prereqs that they didn't take during undergrad. And it looks good on your resume to start in research. So I started working in cardiology research. And then I eventually was like, I'm kind of tired of going to school. I'm in my mid-20s.
Yeah.
Like, I'm done with that. So I just kind of stuck with the research aspect of it because I like the science behind it. I think it's really interesting. And reading protocols, you kind of get a feeling for the other trials that have been done and what it has looked like, you know, previously. And you'll learn a lot about, like, new drugs and, you know, that type of thing. I mean, there are frustrations in that industry too, obviously, yeah, like the FDA and stuff. But, but yeah, that's why I just stuck with it because I thought it was interesting.
Good. Yeah, it is. It's curious how all that, a lot of the frustrations stem from a lot of regulations and all that. I'm curious. So what have you seen in terms of, like, firsthand kind of FDA type stuff that's just aggravating?
Well, they're very frustrating in terms of, like, so first of all, pharmaceutical companies, if they don't like something that you're doing with a trial or they think you put too many, like, ineligible patients or something on, they can rat you out to the FDA and then they'll come and audit you. And if they do that, they're very picky about, like, the language. I know there are doctors who've been frustrated before where they're like, well, you didn't document this correctly. And they're like, well, that's just like a matter of, like, it's ridiculous that we even have to, like, you should just know that's a thing or whatever it is. And sometimes for example, if a sponsor and a physician agree to something to let a patient on the trial and they're technically not eligible, that would be a waiver. They probably would not accept that. So then you wouldn't be able to use that patient in your actual data analysis because they were technically ineligible. Even if it's just a matter of, can they go on and they're on this drug? They would have a problem with that. Just, yeah. And then they come every once in a while too, just to kind of check in and monitor, you know, what you're doing and how you're doing.
Yeah. Yeah. Did you get back to teaching there? Did you get have to during your first year? I imagine the principal would have to come in and check on you a few times throughout the year.
Yeah, they have to come and observe, and they would. Yeah.
How was that?
It was. I didn't really have too bad of an experience. I always hated when they did because you felt like you were under this microscope or something and you get really nervous and that type of thing. You're like, okay, this person's watching me and they're in the back writing down, like, as you're talking. They're just, like, writing. You're like, oh my gosh, is this good or bad? It always ended up good for me, like, at the end of the day when it came to the actual, you know, report or whatever. And but it was a little nerve-wracking because, like, you feel like, well, you know, I can't. I mean, not that you should step out of line anyway, but just you feel like it's even more like pressure to perform, I guess.
Yeah, you gotta toe things even more. Gotta make sure you're really getting all those standards and getting all that stuff in. Make sure you got all their best practices and yada yada. Yep, I hear you. So I don't. You don't have kids now.
I do not, no.
Would you? If you had children, do you think you would send them to a public school at this point after seeing what you've seen? Or is it something you haven't given any thought about, or no?
No, I wouldn't. I would not send my, if I had kids, I would either do, like, homeschooling or a private school. I would prefer homeschool because I think homeschooling, I mean, I think the best people to teach your own kids and know what their needs would be is you, or like you and your partner or whatever. So I think that would be the best option. But then if you can't, I think private school, I would rather do that than public school. I know my nephew, he's in high school and he had to transfer from public school because of some issues that he had. And he went to a private school and his whole demeanor changed. he was much happier and that type of thing. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's wild. Even, like, you think about high school, kids would be sort of in their lane. They'd have their style, their demeanor, you know, wired in already. But like, I've heard that before, you know, kids, like, even in high school, like, come out of public school and either go to, you know, get in a homeschool program or find a private school or something. And just the changes that happen, right? You go from, you know, actually believing in yourself, actually feeling, you know, like you can do something, you can do this, you know, it's wild. It's wild. And I don't know, but anyway, all right. Well, so if people are curious, say they want to find some of your tweets and whatnot, where should they go?
That's an interesting place to be. Yeah.
Where can they find you?
So I'm on Twitter as Allie Jill Tennessee. So it's A-L-I-J-I-L-L-T-N. I also am on Instagram, but I'm private right now for some personal reasons that I'm not going to get into. So I would just go to Twitter if you wanted to find me.
Good deal. Good deal. I will link to that. Always enjoyable. Always enjoyable. But all right. Well, I appreciate it. For your time.
Thanks.
Y'all, that was Allie. It was a fun conversation. It was a good conversation, and I kind of like that it was a little different, broke things up a little bit for me anyway. I think when parents have a hard time seeing inside the school system. If your child goes to school, you know, you see what comes home at the end of the day. You talk to the teacher once in a while. You go in for a conference twice a year, and that's kind of what you get. And so the behind the scenes, the planning, the standards, the rigmarole that goes into teaching, you're not privy to. So I kind of hope you all enjoyed hearing some of what teachers go through, and what is actually happening at school. So there's that. If you enjoyed that, let me know. If you didn't, let me know. If you want me to just stick with homeschooling folk, then that's cool. Just give me a shout. homesteadsandhomeschools@gmail.com. And you can find me on Twitter at HSNHSPod. Right now I'm over on Patreon, patreon.com/thelibertyhippie. If you want to help me out there, you can also do some cryptocurrency donations if that's your thing. I think you can, there's a link somewhere on the website, and I'll put that in the show notes, but I think there's a shortcut link. Anyway, if those aren't your things, crypto, Patreon, homesteadsandhomeschools.com/Amazon. Click through when you buy something, and it helps me out a little bit. So do that. And what else? What else is there? I hope you all had a fabulous May, and June is here, and it's almost summertime, guys. It's almost summertime. Hard to believe 2020 is almost halfway through. Who knows? Who knows what else? What other crazy, crazy nonsense this year has in store for us? I'm almost looking forward to it. Hopefully I'll still be here for you, reading you the riot act, telling you all sorts of stories, and keeping you up to date. So that's all for today, and I'll remind you guys again, like I do at the end of every show, to get out there, sow those seeds of liberty, and we can all reap sheaves of freedom together. I'm gonna ride us his dream.